Hey everyone, Mr. Brown here. The weather is getting really warm where I am, so I grabbed all of our summer toys from the garage. It seems like winter had just got started, but somehow it's already summer again. The cycle of the seasons is one of my favorite cycles. Good question, Squeaks. A cycle is kind of a pattern. It's a list of steps that happens in the same order over and over again. Some cycles repeat every year, like the cycle of the seasons from spring to summer to fall to winter and back to spring again. And other cycles are shorter, like the cycle of the moon, which looks like it grows bigger and smaller every month. Why don't I take a break and we can learn about some other cycles that we've talked about here on SciShow Kids. Awesome. Well, why don't we start with the seasons? Let's find out why seasons happen in the first place.
Spring is here! Now, instead of building snow forts and licking icicles, we can skateboard and ride our bikes, and we don't have to worry about Squeaks getting rusty in the snow. Speaking of seasons, you know we have four of them, spring, summer, autumn, and winter, but do you know why we have more than one season? Well, we have seasons because the Earth is tilted. Instead of standing straight up and down, it leans a little bit. Whoa, how'd that happen? A really, really long time ago, billions of years ago, scientists think something big hit the Earth. The impact was so strong that it knocked our planet over a little bit, so now Earth is tilted. And our tilted planet travels around the sun, completing one full trip all the way around every year. I mean, that's what a year is, the time it takes for the Earth to go around the sun once. And depending on where the Earth is in its journey around the sun, our exposure to sunlight changes. That means the seasons change. That's why we have four seasons in one year. Sometimes during the year, part of the Earth tilts toward the sun. Sometimes it tilts away from the sun. When the part of the planet you're on is tilted toward the sun, it's, you guessed it, summer. When it's tilted away from the sun, it's, yep, winter. And when it's in between, well, the weather's pretty much in between too. That's when we have spring and autumn. They're both a little bit warm and a little bit cool and often windy. But if the season also depends on where on Earth you happen to live, that means that not everyone experiences the same season at the same time. It can be summer in some parts of the world, when it's winter in others, because those different parts of the planet are getting different amounts of sunlight. When the northern hemisphere is tilted toward the sun in the summertime, the southern hemisphere is tilted away. So it's wintertime there. So the tiltiness of our planet explains a lot. It's why we have seasons and why it's not always winter or always summer all of the time. And it also helps us understand why different parts of the world can experience different seasons at the same time.
That's so cool. It might be warm here now, but it's winter in the southern hemisphere. Next, what about the moon? Earlier I mentioned that the moon looks like it's changing every month, getting smaller and then bigger and then smaller again. Why does that happen? Let's watch another video.
If you ever look up at the moon in the night sky, say before you go to bed, you've probably noticed that as the days and weeks go by, the moon looks like it's changing shape. Some nights, it's a little sliver, and some nights, a few weeks later, it's a big bright circle. Well, the moon doesn't actually change shape, but our view of it does. Why? Well, the moon, just like the Earth, has a day side and a night side, a part that's facing the sun and a part that's not. So when we see a little sliver of bright moon, we're seeing a little part of the moon that's facing the sun, while the rest of the side that's facing us is dark. And the size and the shape of that sliver of lit up moon changes because the moon orbits or moves around Earth. It takes the moon about 1 month to make one full orbit around the Earth. And as it moves around our planet, the daytime side of the moon, the side that's lit up from the sun, is facing in different directions as we see it from Earth. This means that every night we get a slightly different view of the moon. And during its month-long trip in orbit around the Earth, the bright part of the moon appears to grow and then shrink from right to left. The different shapes that we see of the lit up part of the moon are called phases. And there are eight phases of the moon. The first phase is the new moon. This is when the nighttime side of the moon, the side that's facing away from the sun, is what we can see from Earth. The moon is still up there, but because it's the dark side that's facing us, we can't see it during the new moon phase. The next phase is called the crescent phase. This is when the moon looks like a little sliver, kind of like the tip of your fingernail. After the crescent comes the quarter moon. This is when the moon looks like a half circle. And the next phase is called gibbous. A gibbous moon is when it's missing just a little sliver of light and it's almost full. And that's what's next. The moon is at its brightest at the full moon. That's when the fully lit up side of the moon is facing us, so we see a big bright circle. But we're only halfway through our phases. After the full moon, the lit up part of the moon appears to shrink. And just like how it grew from right to left, the sunny side of the moon will shrink from right to left too. So after the moon is full, it starts to shrink back down to a gibbous moon. But this time, you'll notice that the left side is shining bright instead of the right. After the gibbous phase, the moon will look like half a circle when it reaches the quarter moon phase again. And then, after a few days, it shrinks down to a little sliver again, the second crescent moon. After that, the tiny sliver shrinks all the way down until the lit up side of the moon can't be seen at all. Now, the moon is a new moon again. It's the same old moon, but it's gone through a month-long cycle of phases, and it's ready to start all over. Like I said, it takes a month for the moon to go through all eight phases. In fact, our word month comes from the word moon, because it takes a month for the moon to go from new moon through all of its phases and back to the new moon again. So tonight, before you go to bed, take a look out the window. If the sky is clear, can you see the moon? If you can, what phase is it in? Is it the bright part of the right side or the left side? As the days go by, keep an eye on it and watch how the moon looks like it's changing shape. You can even make drawings to keep track of how it changes from day to day. Now you know that the moon doesn't really change shape. We just see different amounts of the sunny side of the moon as it makes its monthly trip around the Earth.
Hey, what do you know? The cycle involves the sun too. Now, the cycle of the seasons and the moon happen over pretty long periods of time, a whole year or a whole month. But other cycles are a lot faster. For example, there's another one I like called the water cycle. It's all about how water goes from being in a cloud to a raindrop to the ground and back up into a cloud again. Let's learn more.
When you're thirsty, nothing is better than a nice cool drink of water. Oh, and it looks like my plant could use a drink of water too. Did you ever stop to think about where our water comes from? Sure, when you get a drink of water, it might come from a faucet or a bottle. And I get my flower here water from a watering can. But you know what? The water that comes out of the faucet and the watering can may once have been part of a cloud, or a snowflake, or even the ocean. Awesome, right? And it's because of something called the water cycle. Now, a cycle is a set of steps that repeat over and over. When you get to the last step in a cycle, you go back to the beginning and go through the steps again. For example, every year there are four seasons: spring, summer, fall, and winter. And when winter's over, it's time for spring again. We go back to the beginning of the cycle. In the water cycle, all of the water on Earth goes through a set of steps that repeat over and over. Let's start with a step in our water cycle where we open up our umbrellas. That's right, Squeaks, rain. Rain is water that falls from the sky. Some rainwater soaks into the ground, but a lot of it flows into little creeks and streams and then ends up in rivers, lakes, and eventually the ocean. And then something really interesting happens. Some of this water changes. You might have noticed that after it rains, some water is left on the ground, like in puddles that you can jump in. But what happens to all that water? It seems like it's there one day, but then after a little while, it's gone. Well, that water didn't just disappear. When the sun comes out and the ground gets warm, water can change into a different form. We call this form water vapor. And water vapor is a gas. The air we breathe, it's a bunch of different gases mixed together. And like the gases that make up air, you can't see water vapor gas. When the sun shines on rivers, lakes, and oceans, some of the water changes into water vapor. And then the water vapor goes up high, very high up into the sky. And it gets pretty cold up there. So when the water vapor gets high enough, it starts to get cool. And as water vapor cools down, it changes back into little drops of liquid water. You can actually see water vapor change into water drops right at home. All you need is a mirror or window and your mouth. Put your face close to the mirror or window. Open your mouth nice and wide and breathe out. What happens? The glass gets foggy. That's because there's water vapor in your warm breath. And when the water vapor in your breath touches the cool glass, it changes into teeny tiny droplets. A lot of the droplets together make the glass look cloudy. And up in the sky, a lot of water droplets together make clouds. When there's a lot of water in a cloud, the cloud starts to get darker. White fluffy clouds start to turn gray. And as the clouds get grayer, the water in them gets heavier. When the water gets too heavy, it falls right back out of the clouds as rain. And rain is where we started in the cycle. We made it all the way back to the beginning. Now the water cycle can start all over again. All the water on our great big Earth goes through this same cycle over and over. It falls to the ground as rain or snow, and soon the water ends up in a river, lake, or ocean. From there, it heats up and turns into vapor. And when the vapor rises into the sky and cools off, it comes right back down. So the water that you drink and the water that's in my watering can right now might once have been part of a raindrop that fell into the ocean on the other side of the world. Think about that the next time you take a drink.
Right. Isn't that neat? It takes so many steps just to get a nice, refreshing glass of water. Are you ready for one more cycle, Squeaks? Awesome, because I think this one is especially cool. It's about salmon, because salmon have cycles too. Every year. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's watch one more video.
Wow, Squeaks, that is a tricky riddle.
Can you help me with it? What animal goes by 7 different names over its life, changes color from stripy to silver to red, lives in the river and the ocean, and what was the last clue, Squeaks?
That's right, and is an awesome parrot.
Okay,
Ooh, is it a salmon?
Yes, that is a really good riddle, Squeaks. Salmon are amazing animals, and they have one of the coolest life cycles. Life cycles are the changes they go through as they grow up and live their lives. You know how you were a baby once, and now you're a kid, and someday you'll be a teenager, and then you'll be a grown-up? Well, salmon go by 7 different names over their lives because there are 7 different stages of their life cycle. Like all fish, they start out as eggs. That's the first thing they're called. An egg. In the fall, an adult female salmon lays her eggs. Salmon usually like to lay their eggs in moving water, like in a river or stream. The eggs stay in their safe little spot in the river all winter, and in the spring, they hatch. At this stage, the baby fish are still attached to the yolks of their egg for food and nutrients. This is when they get their second name, alevins. There are lots of different species of salmon, so depending on which kind of salmon they are, the alevins spend a few weeks or a few months close to where they hatched until they grow big enough to move on to the next stage of their life. In the third stage of a salmon's life, it's called a fry. Now it's ready to eat real food and swim. The fry go on little adventures away from their nest, but they don't go very far. They stick to the stream they were born in. By the end of the summer, fry grow into the fourth stage, when they're called par. Par are kind of like teenager salmon, almost grown up, but not quite. Par are still really small, but they're getting bigger. They swim all around their home stream and develop a special design on their scales to help them blend in and stay safe from other animals that might try to eat them. The par continue to eat and grow, and when they're ready to migrate away from their childhood home, they lose that special pattern on their scales and become smolts. Now they're in the fifth stage of their lives. This is when the young salmon leave their streams and head for bigger waters, like rivers and lakes. Depending on where they are, they follow the rivers all the way downstream to either the Pacific Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean. Most salmon are born high in mountain streams, so it takes them a long time to get all the way to the ocean. When the smolts start their journey, they still look a lot like par, but by the time they get to the water that joins the ocean, they're big and silver to blend into their new surroundings. Now they get their sixth name. They're adults. All different species of salmon live together in the ocean in big groups called schools, and they can live there for a really long time, for up to 8 years. After they've lived their whole adult life in the ocean, something really amazing happens. It's time for the salmon to have babies. This is when salmon enter their final stage of life, when they're known as spawning adults. Spawning means they're about to lay or fertilize eggs. But do you remember what we said earlier about where salmon eggs hatch? That's right, salmon are born in mountain streams. So how do the adult salmon living in the ocean lay their eggs all the way at the tops of mountain streams? This is why Squeaks gave us the clue that salmon are amazing parents. When salmon are ready to have babies, they remember where they were born and make the same long journey they made when they were smolts, only this time they do it backwards. The adult salmon leave the ocean and swim back up the rivers. They swim for hundreds of kilometers against the current of the river. They have to jump over waterfalls and sometimes even dams. It's a really tough trip. This is when the salmon can change from silver to red, and some kinds of male salmon even change shape. Some of them develop a lower jaw that sticks out like a hook and a big hump on their back. After all these changes and years swimming in big rivers and then oceans and then rivers again, spawning salmon return to the exact same stream where they were born to lay and fertilize their own eggs. And then the salmon cycle of life starts all over again. After the spawning salmon lay their eggs in the fall, the eggs will hatch in the spring with new baby alevins. That was a great riddle, Squeaks. Salmon are so interesting to learn about.
Watching those videos was a ton of fun, but I can't wait to get outside to play. Thanks for learning about cycles with me and Squeaks, everyone. And we'll see you next time here at the Fort.